were created for a cemetery tour. And they'll be here for everybody to look at. There's Sergeant Dooley's blood, Harrigan, they're all in there. The information displayed on the panels, all these panels, gives a glimpse into the lives and events of early Lanesville and the people who lived here. It would be impossible to include every story, but here are a few. Let's start with the Lanes. John Lane was born about 1652, his wife Dorcas Wallace, in about 1661. They married in 1680 and had 11 children, all born in the Massachusetts Bay Colonies, 5 in Cape Elizabeth, and 6 in Gloucester's Annisquam Parish. Just remember, it's not Lanesville yet. The story has always been that they left the Northern Massachusetts Bay Colony, now Casco Bay, Maine, in 1675 due to Indian attacks, staying on the East Coast. They made their way to Gloucester after 1689. John was a farmer, a fisherman, an original member of the Third Church of Annisquam, which was organized in 1748. The 11 children married into the Riggs, Woodbury, York, Finson, remember Finson, Thurston, Tucker, Harrigan, and Griffin families. Their ninth child, Benjamin, and his wife, Elizabeth Griffin, had 16 children. In 1700, John Lane acquired land lots 1, 2, and 3 northeast of Lane's Cove. A Flatstone Cove, excuse me. It's not Lane's Cove yet. The deed from Nathaniel Day to John Lane, recorded on October 15, 1700, reads in part, a parcel of upland containing 18 acres, more or less, situated lying on the northeast side of Flatstone Cove, so commonly called, it being the three first lots of the Cape Division. The interesting note is that only 4 trees mark the boundaries, a white oak, a black birch, a beech, and a pine. On November 9th, 1704, Lane was also granted and given by the Common Council an additional 10 acres of upland ground, most of it at the head of his own land. It was also bounded by trees, or in some cases, stumps. We've outlined this. We've outlined this in pink. That's the uplands around Flatstone Cove, or Lane's Cove as we know it today, and the green. And this is a rough estimate. The green is represents the first 3 lots of the subdivision that went all the way to Halibut Point. They're about 6-acre lots, and they went to what was called the main highway, which is now Washington Street. So Washington Street was really Main Street. The blue represents where the ocean may have been before the granite piers and the walls were constructed. So I monkeyed around with this photo right here, and I took out everything that the granite company put in, and that's what was left. Mm-hmm. So that's part of what John Lane saw when he came here. A nice view of the ocean, a little cove. I'm going to jump around now a little bit here. In a newspaper article in 1889, fisherman Eli Morgan told a reporter in 1812, when he was 7 years old, that he remembers only 20 houses from Plum Cove Brook to the Rockport line. When you look at that back wall back there, up on the high part of the back wall, there are 16 of the 20 houses that were here before 1812. A lot of them are still here. I've located the 16 of the 20. The two oldest date back to 1690. It's the Harrigan House which is 1107A Washington Street, and the McClellan House, which is down off McClellan Lane. I don't know a lot about that house. I need to look into that because that's a very old house. The Harridan House, right here. The Harridan House also served as the first meeting place for the Congregational Church in 1828, when a group of Lanesville residents, unhappy with the direction, broke off from the Anasquam Village Church. The 16 houses are displayed, I said that up there. One of the locations that we are missing is John and Dorcas Lane's homestead. But a couple of deeds and a newspaper article gives us some clues. In his deed recorded January 21st, 1735, John Lane gives to his sons, James and Josiah, in consideration of love, goodwill, and affection, 2/3 of a wharf that they did build near my house. That's clue number one. In another deed recorded January 7, 1737, shortly before John Lane's death, he gave to his three sons, Joseph, Benjamin, and Job, a portion of the wharf, warehouse, and flake yard at Flagstone Cove. It states equally to them, their heirs and assigns the full 1/3 part of a certain wharf in said Gloucester, which wharf lays to the westward of my dwelling house and runs into Flagstone Cove. And it goes on to say, together with 1/3 part of ye warehouse standing on or adjoining to said wharf. While searching for the location of John Lane's original house out, we get another clue from the Gloucester Daily Times. The article from 1912 was written and tells us that John Lane built his house on a flat stone where Charles Evans Barn now stands. Anybody in here know where Charles Evans Barn was? Because we need to know. It's on Andrew Street, I'll tell you that. The 1934 city assessor's map gives us a better view of Andrew Street. Well, here's Andrew Street going down to the cove. This lot right here. The red highlight area is 22 and 24 Andrew Street, and the Gloucester City Directory in 1894 lists Charles Evans as a blacksmith living at 20 Andrew Street. So with these photos and the clues, it's most likely in the vicinity of 20 and 22 Andrew Street. So, this is the Lanesville Fish House, looking from the water. This is an old wooden pier, right here. You see the blank spot right there in the middle between the fish house and the granite? Mm-hmm. That's where the wooden pier was. Mm-hmm. This barn, or building, whatever it was, this is Lanes Cove Road. That barn was sitting on that wall. That wall was built in the 1840s when Jonathan Harridan sold land to the pear company so they could build Proprietor's Road. Proprietor's Road went around the head of Lane's Cove. In total, it appears that John Lane accumulated about at least 63 acres of land, including woodlots, swamps, and marshes. A copy of these deeds and photos are on the Lane panel. That's the first one when you walk in, you can see.